No, they have to. One of the things is that the UVOA has history of every minister's ministry. And when you get down to the three pre-candidates, you ask the UUA for their, what's it called? I don't know, there's a specific name for it, but basically they'll write you back and say there were no issues in any ministry with this minister, or two ministries ago this person was involved in a shady financial thing, or, you know, so it's really important that they're completely vetted by the UUA.
People are asking how we know. So, in the past, some of the candidates will actually have some sermons online that the search committee can view before, you know, during the process, so that we get a sense of what people's sermons are like and what they're like.
Yes, absolutely. That would. If it doesn't happen, something's missing. Definitely, yes.
I've never been through this process before. Does the congregation know who the candidates are?
No.
Okay.
No, they don't. In fact, the search committee is going to be keeping you updated with, they're going to have a bulletin board somewhere, and they're going to keep you updated as to their progress on this and what they're doing and how it's all going until January. And January, when they get the applications, they're radio silent. Many of these ministers have not told their own congregations they're in search. This is a small community of people across the United States, and it would really be horrible if information like that got out. So they try to just keep it with a smaller group of people who have taken a covenant of confidentiality on this. Even, you know, contacting all the background checks and all of the, what do they call that? Sorry, I have Lyme disease, I lose words. All of the
references?
References, and then even hidden references. You know, you may be talking to a reference and they say, oh, well, you know, Sandy had a lot of information about that. But you have to ask, the search committee has to ask the minister if it's okay to talk to Sandy, that hidden reference. They were not directly put on the list of references that were allowed. So anyway, there's lots of work going on, yes.
I'm thinking about congregational access, like the answer that you just finished the little,
finish the timeline.
Yeah, the timeline.
Okay, so let's say the search committee has decided that they want to bring in three pre-candidates. So Friday night, there's a friendly potluck dinner somewhere. It's usually at a search committee member's house. Saturday, they will be doing a tour of this facility, and it has to be completely private, so the search committee is going to have to figure out when nobody's here. I've had churches actually have to take these candidates in at 6 in the morning, you know, to take them on. It was the only time, because the church is busy, right? You got stuff going on Saturdays. Our church, as many of you might know, is all glass. So even if we could say, okay, good, there's a meeting going on over there, but they're going to be in that meeting from 10 to 12, the walls were all glass. We couldn't even count on that. So we had to do some finagling to get the tour of the facility. But it's obviously very important. Another thing to mention is that on these pre-candidate visits, the minister will be bringing their partner. And the search committee will need to be paying for that. I'll get to a budget in a minute. So they have these three weekends in February and March, as I said. By April, they will, with all of the knowledge they have, with all of the backing of you, picking them to do this job, they will choose a candidate. They will already have set up with the interim minister the candidating week. And that is 10 days of this minister that they have chosen. They come in generally, some come Friday, Saturday. They come on a Saturday with their partner. You have to find a house for them to stay in, or a place anyway for them to stay in those 10 days. They preach on Sunday and basically run the church for the week. They meet with everybody. And that can be in the way of large church potlucks. It's helpful to have more directed meetings with them by committee. We're the membership committee, and we're meeting with them from 4 to 5, and then stewardship, the schedule becomes really, really busy during that week. They'll meet with the interfaith council in the area. They'll meet with other Unitarian ministers in this area. They'll be looking at real estate. Then they'll preach on the second Sunday. They'll preach twice. You'll get to see them both times. All of you, everybody in the congregation, can come see them twice. And after the second Sunday, you will vote on whether or not this is your next minister or not.
On that Sunday?
On the second Sunday, right after the service. Yes?
Just to understand it a little better, if there are 40 ministers in search, and they put their name out to 16 congregations each, like how many, when you're down to those three, could one minister be in those three in the single congregation?
They could be in a couple companies.
Yeah, yes. So they could. And then before this candidating week, has there been an accepted offer? Are we saying we can pay you X and you're willing to take X?
At the end,
and that's already worked out, or does that happen after the candidate?
Right, no. No. The work for their contract will be going on from January on. And there's going to be a team that's set up between the search committee and the board. That we'll call the negotiating team. It's usually a board member, a search committee member, and perhaps a respected other member in the church. It would be great if they were an attorney. And those three people look at the contracts that the UUA provides as templates to use, and they will fill in all of their information on creating a contract that they would like to present to their candidates, including salary and housing and insurance and whether you have to come the second week of July even though you're in vacation for the summer. Yeah, I mean, whatever it is that they want to put in.
Has that all taken place during the pre-candidate stage?
So the contract will be made up. And on the Sunday that the pre-candidate preaches in a neutral pulpit, the search committee then has lunch with them afterwards in the town where they preached. And if they don't talk about anything else during that lunch, they have to say, if we were to make you an offer this afternoon, is there anything you want to change in the contract that you've seen?
So they've already seen
Absolutely.
It before they yes. preach.
As
in the congregational okay. record.
Yeah. Yes.
There's a ton of information here. My memory is not so good, and there's a lot I'm missing. So I just like to point out for myself and everybody else here that this is being videotaped, and I'm assuming that this. Your talk and all these questions will be available online for us to review based upon reminder of what we missed.
Yes.
Plus, anybody who's not here should know that this is available for viewing.
Yes, thank you for stating that.
And you can also ask
I just need to finish this. There's much more of the timeline I go, and then I'm open to questions, and then I have something else to talk about too. But candidating week, second Sunday, you're taking a vote of reimburse. And the board is checking on that to see what that actually means. No, what are they called? Votes from afar. No proxy is allowed.
No proxies?
What about absentee ballot or absentee ballots?
Needs a quorum, thank you.
No absentee.
Have to have a quorum, no. You have to be in place to vote. And the minister will not come to this congregation unless there's at least 95% approval of them coming. Why would they? Why would they come to a congregation that only 80% of the congregation wants them? They won't. And that number, that approval level, keeps going up. there are some candidates that say that unless there's 98% approval vote, they will not come to that congregation. So, yes?
So, is it 98% of a two-thirds quorum?
Yes.
Or is 98% of the entire...
The people there.
The people that are in the sanctuary at the time of the vote.
Right, but do we have to have a certain percentage of our total congregation?
Well, you certainly have to have a quorum. It's work that the board and the search committee will be doing. They're going to announce this Sunday way ahead of time. It's incredibly important for the future of your congregation. We, like, everybody had to be there. That's all there was to it. Yes?
When they're here for that last week, would they be in negotiating with another?
No.
So they're already kind of committed to us.
Yes.
So there's an offer day, like this year, it's up, I think March 29th.
Yeah.
Our guy in Boston who oversees, I think, almost a matchmaker, Keith Prunt, he's got this process honed down to it's an art. And in order to help facilitate the best matches for everyone, ministers and congregations, he solicits up front. Do you mind taking
No, not at all.
He solicits from congregations and ministers, what are your preferences? Yes, no's, and maybes, and your yeses, put them in order. And then he does some behind-the-scenes work and talks to folks and so then come offer day. So he does this right up, a few days in advance of offer day. No congregation can make an